We're waiting for a few people to get on, but we want to solicit your prayers, and we'll just wait until we get a few more people on, a few more of our followers waiting for. Okay, there's one. Hi, Barry. Hi, Limitless. Since 1968, we've got Justin Davis. How are you doing? Hi, Ernest. We had Ernest on last week. You can watch that on YouTube. It was great. Penny. Celia, listen, we've been asked to get everybody out and to pray for Pastor Dr. Price. So if you can remember, it's very serious right now. He's in the hospital with COVID, and so please, 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 we're asking you to pray. Hi, you guys. We were just asked to pray for Dr. Price. He's in the hospital. Fred Price is in the hospital with COVID.
Oh, wow.
But we got a call just before we came on to ask everybody to pray for Dr. Fred Price.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
in the hospital, man, with COVID.
I was I was thinking about him the other day.
Were you?
Yeah.
We just keep him in your prayers. Yeah. And so we just believe a full recovery for him.
Amen.
It's very difficult time for a lot of people.
Yes.
My sister has COVID now.
Yes, his sister's in the hospital too.
And she just got off of oxygen, so she's recovering. Want to keep everybody up in prayer. So I know you probably will probably talk about it. You know folks that have COVID and have recovered, and we know the stories from one end to the other end.
Yeah, my dad passed away a few weeks ago from COVID.
So we're all impacted. So, but they asked us to pray, and we're going to pray. You want to pray at the beginning or at the end?
Well, let's pray at the end. Is that good with you guys?
Yeah.
Okay. So we're happy to see you guys. Yeah. You guys are family friends. I don't know how it happened. It just happened. How did it happen, you guys? It seems like you've always been in our life now. When did we meet?
I met you guys first. Yeah. I met you first.
Yeah, then we met. Okay.
Yes, I met at
Central, right?
No.
Before, we had a video, I think.
Was it when you guys were? I was staying at the. I wasn't even living here yet. I was staying at the hotel, the Sofitel.
That's right.
And Kurt's room was right next to mine.
Kurt Franklin. Yes. Right.
Yes. And that's when it first exploded.
And right. We were just.
Kurt was there.
But somehow we just stayed friends.
And then you guys had a party after, I think, something on Wilshire by the Wiltern.
Oh, yeah.
Little restaurant there.
That little restaurant that was on the side.
Right. Oh, yeah.
Was it our
parking?
I had a party there because Mark had a party there, too.
Yeah.
Wait a minute.
That's right. Mark had a party.
That's crazy.
And you were just a little girl.
Yes.
Oh, my gosh.
At the church.
Church, right. And so we went to the same church together. I mean, y'all. We love these people. We're friends for real.
We did So Laughable together.
Family, we did So Laughable together. But even before that, we had the baby shower for Imani, their first daughter.
Yeah. At the house. So beautiful. We had it at your house. And I gained about 60 pounds.
You were full with babies.
I had preeclampsia that day and didn't know it. So right after that, I went to the hospital and they had to quickly deliver because I had preeclampsia.
That's right. So was it the next day or the day after?
I was on set. A few
days.
And she called me and she's like, I gotta go. You know, they want me. She went to see the doctor, and the doctor said, no, go to the hospital now. Eclampsia, and they had to induce labor.
Yeah. I never told you this story, but I'm gonna tell you this story now. We were having your party at our house.
Yes.
And there were some people that came in, and we love art. We have a lot of art, especially Haitian art. Mm-hmm. And I remember these people that came into our house who kept asking, well, what do they do? What do they do? And they were looking at our artwork. And I don't know what business they're in. What do they do? I was so mad. They were Caucasian. I was so mad.
Well,
was that the day of our shower?
Yeah.
That was the day of your shower.
Yeah.
Who was that?
Because, you know, we had some people there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we had people from the network and stuff like that. Well, you know, they expect us not to know art or have anything.
So I was like, how many years is that? 18, 19 years later, I'm telling you this story?
Yes.
Well, 19. No, actually, Imani is about to turn 20. So that was like,
20 years. Like, 20.
She's 20. The party that we had was that 16 or was that 17?
Her sweet 16.
Was that sweet 16?
Oh, they came to one of her birthday parties out here, remember?
Yes.
Yeah.
What party was that? Because it wasn't 16. Maybe 7.
Maybe 7 at the restaurant. We turned to.
It was
DJ, you're a DJ.
How much time has gone by?
How long was that ago?
That was like 3 years ago.
3 years ago? Well, you know, it was pre-COVID. I know that.
It was definitely pre-COVID.
Yes.
Definitely pre-COVID. Definitely.
You got Maggie Lathan on. Do you guys know Maggie Lathan?
Hey. Somebody said he got a Tiger Woods hat on. I'm like, and?
Yeah, that's Tiger Woods. Yes. That's the logo, Tiger Woods.
I'm having a bad hair day. So this is, I'm getting a haircut in about an hour. So that's why.
Well, yeah, this is the week of.
And I'm a huge baller.
We're calling it the week of love because Valentine's Day is getting ready to come up.
It's Sunday, and we know something special on Sunday.
What happened on Valentine's Day for you guys? Did you get married on Valentine's Day?
No.
Where does that come from?
Somebody put it online that we got married on Valentine's Day.
So it's the 19th that you were married.
It was on the 19th.
Okay. So, I want y'all to clarify that because, you know, there's a lot of fake news out there.
Well, sir, please don't get on that.
Fake news.
So it's the 19th of February. But, you know, it's all out there. If you Wikipedia, all that, everybody's saying you were married on Valentine's Day 2000.
And then I said something dumb. I told Claude, I said, well, you know,
Valentine's Day falls on a lot of different days.
A lot of different days. And he says, no, Vicki, it's February 14th, period.
Yeah.
But we've known you guys for a while, we have all gone through a lot in since we met, some of it even together. And we've had our ups and we've had our downs. Yes. We've talked about it personally on the phone a lot and all that. But I want to start. We've cried on the phone together. And that's when you know you've got real friends.
Yes.
You don't have to put on airs. You don't have to be important and talking about what you got and what you drive. Mm-hmm. We've been together with the Bentleys and we've been together with the Toyotas.
With the cute.
Yes.
We've been together in the fabulous houses and we've been together when we didn't know where we were going to stay.
Yes.
Amen. And that's what makes a friend. I know I could call you guys in the good times and the bad times when you feel like you can't share with anybody else sometimes. And we know we can always call you guys.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, thicker than blood.
That's what it's about. You know, that's we learn and we continue to learn that, you know, even in this industry, you know, you get people that ride with you when it's great. You know, you get people that want to ride in the limousine, but when it breaks down, you know.
They are nowhere to be found.
When Flex had 101, our phones rang off the hook. You know, and then when my career kind of slowed down for a second, like the phone calls just stopped you know, the phone stopped ringing. But you guys have always been there.
Always been consistent.
And we always will, because we're not friends because of what you do or why you do it. We're friends because we like you, number one. And you're somebody we can talk to. And number three, you guys throw the bombest party. The real party. But I want to go back to the beginning, kind of. Now, and Flex, when I, you know, you have friends and you know them, but then when you start going through their bio and stuff, you start learning stuff you didn't know. I know you were born and raised in, Harlem.
Harlem, sorry.
From the Bronx. And that's another thing. They say Harlem.
Okay.
Another one. I'm born in the Bronx. I lived in Harlem for quite some time. I lived in Harlem. I lived in Brooklyn. A lot of people, I guess, in Harlem because I was so prevalent in the community and comedy club. You know, that was like a staple in Harlem. So people just, even Eartha Kitt, when she introduced me on, she was like, he's one of the rising TV stars from Harlem.
Oh, man.
Am I going to correct her? No, I'm not going to correct her.
No. You don't mess with the divas.
That's it.
The divas will rain terror on you.
Yeah.
So you let the divas say whatever they want to say.
Amen.
But, I mean, your life in New York, you know, I got to tell you the truth. If I didn't know you, I would think you were this nerd that was born in this upper middle class situation, and it's really nothing like that.
Nothing like that. Total opposite. Grew up in the projects in the Bronx, Clinton Towers. You know, saw a lot. It was great. I have great memories of growing up, and then when 85 hit and crack went rampant, fortunately, it touched my family, and I got to see it up close firsthand, and then to the point where I even turned to dealing it. And, it was almost this feeling of like, you know, you're going to mess up my family, so I'm going to go out here and I'm going to wreak havoc. And it was a time, you know, being just so lost and following my friends because they were making money and I wanted to make money. You know, I was on my own. I didn't want to be a part of what was happening. So I took my time and tried to be this you know, dealer, and that didn't work out too well. I just didn't have the heart.
Thank God, huh?
Yeah, praise God. You know, God doesn't prosper us in certain things.
Yes. And the whole time, even while I was doing it, I just didn't have the heart for it. Seeing people, just seeing our people and what was happening, I just didn't have the heart for it. So thankfully, fast forward, you know, after seeing friends get killed and different things, you know, my mom got clean and my other family members got clean, and I lost a brother to AIDS in 97, but he was clean. It turned it around, you know, and I'm thankful for those struggles. I'm thankful for that time. But, you know, folks look at me now and, you know, might look at me way, but they don't know back in the day, I set it off on you. Real.
What is that song from Jerry Key? You don't know my story.
Yes.
First, I got to say this. Like, he tried to give you a short version of it. But the one that stands out is, to me, I think about, he said that when he was selling drugs, a guy put a gun up to his head and pulled the trigger and it didn't fire.
Oh, come on, Jesus.
Makes you want to shout.
Fucking miracle. Like, he's
come on, Jesus.
Amen. I mean, Claude went through something like that too, where, it makes you wonder with young black men, how we can just even have a life for them. Of course, you have two children. And, you know, I think about that a lot because Claude was real smart and could cipher numbers without pencil or pen, you know, paper or pen. And so...
Right,
those drug dealer kind of things.
But you know, like, how many times do you have a second chance? A lot of young black men don't have a second chance.
Yeah.
And so, you know, you make the wrong first step and that's it.
Yeah.
And so praise God that, you know, you were able to turn around and you're doing some great things, man. We really appreciate it.
I'm thankful. I know that, you know, I just had a calling, and I wasn't going to mess up that second chance. I just was like, you know what? Yeah. I'm getting an opportunity. I'm not going to test it. Because, yeah, people, I had friends that tested.
That test you, man.
They tested that second chance, and they failed. They didn't come out on the right end. So I just was like, I'm not going to blow it. Turn my life around. I got into dancing in the clubs.
Good. Let's talk about the dance.
Yes.
Man, I don't know about that.
Yeah,
so that's how you got your nickname.
My buddy Stretch from New York. He, just said, "Man, come hang with me, man." We started going to clubs, and then I started getting noticed and getting put in music videos, and then we formed this dance crew called the Mop Tops, motivated on precision towards outstanding performance. And choreographed for so many big artists. And they're actually still doing it, you know.
Really?
Yeah, they're still choreographing. I mean, they were before COVID holding huge schools and classes in China and Japan. Like, they're worldwide. Yeah, and now these dancers, now they have a union, they have agents.
A union for those dancers?
Oh, now, yeah, I don't know if they have a union. I know they have agents. I think they're trying to form a union, but there was none of that before. We laid the groundwork for that because there was no representation. We represented ourselves. We fought to not be on video sets for 17 hours and having one meal, not dressing, not being able to stay warm. And like, this is the things that happened in videos back in the day. It was like, whatever, you lucky to be here. And here's
right.
We changed a lot of that.
So Flex, from the time that you had all the drug stuff going on and all that, did you ever think that you would be a TV star, a dancer, a choreographer, which we have to talk about, and marry Shanice? I mean, were these things in your mind, in your heart and your spirit?
I'm going to say something real quick. I'm a firm believer in speaking power and speaking life, and really manifesting things. And first, when I was 14, I was watching Eddie Murphy's Delirious, and I told my mom, I said, "Mom, that's what I'm going to do." And my mom was like, "Okay, baby, all right, that's good." You know, mom.
Yeah, I met your mom.
But my dream was to play in the NBA. So, I wanted to play basketball. I scholarship to college, and that was my dream.
You're like 6'4" or something?
Yeah, 6'4". So that was my dream. But cut a little forward, I was living in Harlem, and I used to put the Right On posters on my wall, like all the, Salt and Pepper. BD, all the people like that. This is before I danced.
Right On magazine.
And yes, all the Word Up magazine. I had a picture of Shanice on my wall.
On your wall, get out of here.
You worked that. Yeah. A photo of him in his room, and when I looked at the photo, I can see my picture on his wall in the background.
Before you guys even met.
Cut forward. So now I'm dancing, right? I'm dancing all over the world. And to answer your question, when I was doing what I was doing in the drugs I knew that I wouldn't be doing that forever. I knew that I would be doing something great. I just knew that it was in me. So me speaking at 14, it just, I guess, took time to come around. But when I was dancing, we were in Europe, and we were at the show called Top of the Pops, biggest show out there. And so I get introduced to who? Shanice. She's there.
Yeah.
And
this was in the 90s.
In the 90s. It was just a
high. Like the early
90s. Yeah, early 90s. It was like a hello, a hi, bye, like a hey.
Nice to meet you.
That was it. So we had the...
No, then he shot a pilot, and a friend of mine, she said, "I met your husband." And I'm like, who?
What?
At Flex Alexander. And I'm like,
she said that.
No, this was like in 90 what?
I did that in like 94?
Probably,
no, before 94.
It was the early 90s.
Early
90s. And I said, what are you talking about? I said, I don't even know Flex. 1999, Flex moved into my apartment building.
Yep.
Right. And I remember him telling us. Yeah.
And then we ended up together.
Yeah. So it's crazy. So and when we met, we just talked as friends, and because I didn't want a relationship, I was single. I think I had been single for like almost a year, and I was happy. I was fine.
And you were hot on a TV show.
No. At this point, Boys in Outer Space, and it was over. It was done.
Yeah.
And I didn't know what I was gonna do.
No, he was okay. Up.
Yeah, I was talking about leaving. I was like, you know what? I would talk to her. I was like, yo, I'm done. I'm like, I'm tired of, if you're not in this clique, if it, I'm like, yo, I'm leaving. I'm going back to New York. She was like, you can't do that. She said, you're too talented for that. She said, and we're just friends. She said, you know, you got to create your own thing. You got to, that's what you got to do.
I said,
that's right. That's right.
That's Shanice.
That's Shanice.
Yeah. So he did. Actually do. I have a show about a father raising his daughter, and and then that's when he, you know, worked on that, pitched it, and
one-on-one was basically, it was kind of loosely pitched around a friend of mine from Harlem who was a single dad young, and we used to give him a hard time because he couldn't go out and hang out and do stuff because he was a single dad. And it was a mixture of that and me seeing a commercial with LL Cool J. It was a Coca-Cola commercial. He was sitting on the steps doing his daughter's hair, and he did these crooked ponytails. I was like, man, that's a show. And that was the birth.
And you told me from the beginning that Kyla Pratt.
Oh, yeah.
You wanted Kyla to
do it. I saw Kyla from the beginning.
Yeah, because she was in a commercial. He said, you see that girl in that commercial?
Yeah.
That's the one
That's who it is. Okay.
So you, that's amazing. Wow. I mean, that love thing. And like I said, I know people know a lot about your story from your reality show and all of that. But we wanted to talk about some of the love aspect. And one of the things that, you know, because it's a, there's so much to life, and we'll talk about some of the other things, but we're just trying to talk right now about the two of you coming together and that love. And I remember you did something that we did, which was date celibate and be celibate.
Yeah.
We did it too. Thank God. We were like, okay, I give it one more week. We need to get married. Because this is cute and everything, but I'm liking this brother right here. So, Lord, I'm trying to do right. You got to help me.
Shami's like, no.
She's like, I don't wait for this.
You already know how it is. It's too much.
So tell us about your journey and meeting and falling in love and all that stuff.
All right. Okay, well, I'll sit my side first. And then...
Yeah, we have we.
Moving to a building. She was on the way to a Lauryn Hill concert. And I was just like, oh, Shanice, hey. She's like, hey. So, you know, we knew of each other. And I was just like, hey, you know, give me info. I'll keep in touch, but not on any, like, yeah, I'm gonna get with you. It was like, oh, so she's like, all right, I gotta go back upstairs because I'm waiting for my cousin. She's late
for the concert.
For the concert. So she's like 35 minutes later, she didn't come back down again. I'm like, I'm out. So I see her 2 weeks later in elevated. I said, all right, now you took forever before, give me a number. And we kept in touch. We
had a really good friendship.
Yeah, we just talked, and
that's what makes it.
But when we officially started dating, we only dated 3 months.
Mm-hmm. 3 or 4 months.
That's how it is.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
When you're doing that celibate date,
you know, celibate.
We can't play around too long here.
Speed up that process.
Yeah.
And it got to work.
That was so deep. Every time.
Cooking right away.
The crazy thing is, every time we would come close to doing anything, the phone would ring or the door would ring. And I said, God telling us. Just wait.
That's a funny show right there.
But you know how tough it was. People don't understand. We lived in the same building. I was on the 5th floor. She was on the 3rd. So I could go there without anybody knowing.
Right.
Yeah.
Sneak on downstairs.
But it was like every time something would happen. And I remember I would be there hanging out. Because, you know, at the beginning, you're just trying to, you know, be cute, make sure everything is right. And I would leave there, man. I would walk up the steps. I'd be farting all the way up the steps. I'd be holding it. I ain't want her to see that yet.
I have a question. You guys were part of the singles ministry at Faithful. Did that have anything to do?
I was there. I brought her.
He brought me. Oh, this, we have a good story on that.
I was the one there.
He brought me there.
I took her there.
And the pastor that the
Donald Bell said
he started talking about ghetto engagements.
Yes.
And he said when people get engaged and for like 5-6 years. He said,
that ain't cool.
The ghetto engagement. He said, that's because they're looking to see if there's anything better out there, you know? Mm-hmm. So he said, a man knows right away when he meets his wife. Mm-hmm. Like, he knows right away.
Yeah, that's true.
So he said that. So we driving back, and I just wanted to, you know, mess with
this. This is after 3 months.
So we driving back, and I said, let's do it. She said, what? So let's just get married. She said, huh? I just wanted to see, you know, I was just, you know, put my foot in the water.
Just got to get the feel going on there.
So she didn't react, you know, negatively. So I was like, okay. So she might be a little open to it.
Let me tell you how he got me. So I went on tour. And so we were friends for a little bit. And then about dating. And then I had to go on tour. So that's when you kissed me for the first time.
Oh, yeah.
I said, so that when I go on tour, maybe think someone meets somebody.
No, I go to her rehearsal, and I said, you know what? You always talking about soulmates and all this stuff. I said, your soulmate could be staring you right in your face.
Bam! And that's when it hit me that, wait a minute, he might be right. Like, that's when it all kind of, mm-hmm.
How many years ago was that now?
February 19th, it'll be 21.
21 years.
21. Wow. All right. Go for it. Two kids.
And it doesn't feel like it. It feels like
you guys have been through some stuff.
Yes, we have.
Okay. Yeah. We can talk about that a little bit, but I want to know through the ups and downs, especially the financial ups and downs, we have had them too, where you got money, everybody loves you, then it's gone, all that. How do you keep a relationship in the midst of all that? Because we know it can be very, very rough.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, definitely, you know, prayer for sure, and communicating, and just being, because it's not perfect, and people sometimes they go, oh yeah, I got the perfect. Like, no, it's not perfect. We have our issues. We have times where she don't want to be around me, and
yeah,
who is this dude?
I go downstairs, she stay upstairs, or whatever. It's you gotta wanna do it. You have to.
Yes.
Be two people that are willing to put in the work, because it's work that's worth it.
Yeah,
it's worth it.
Yeah, it's not easy. I mean, but it's worth it.
Yeah, and even
did you ever feel like you wanted?
It gets easier. Let me say that.
Did you feel like you wanted to throw in the towel? Sometimes I know we do. I do more than Claude.
We had times.
Sometimes I'm like, look, I'm over you, brother.
No, we had some times where she, you know.
Yeah, we had some times where this.
She had her foot up, you know, ready to, you know, boom, but. You know, thankfully, we worked through it. And
we've gone to counseling.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, we've had our ups and downs.
Yes. Yes.
But
I'm thankful. I'm thankful that, you know, I have a wife that I have. I'm thankful that she has a heart that she has. And
yes,
I just say that, you know, I'm, you know, I know that I'm super blessed and I hate to say lucky, but, aww, you know, I know that. You know? And
aww, you
no, it's real. It's real. Bro, as a man, I mean, look, I grew up with no father. I had to learn everything on the fly. I'm still learning how to be a father. I had to continually learn.
And you're a good father.
And
also how to be a husband.
Yes, and be a husband. Continue.
What is that?
Really? Yes, because I had no picture of it, you know, at all. You know, my dad, he had, you know, families everywhere, and I had my grandmother and my mother that raised me, and I just had two strong women to give me an idea of what it is to be a man, and all I could do was do my best, you know what I mean? And I'm thankful that I just get to take every day to get better, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that's good.
Yeah,
that's
I mean, it's now Shanice, you were in Pittsburgh and you sang with Ella Fitzgerald, but I want to know why I think of you with Patti LaBelle. Were you ever with Patti LaBelle?
No, you know, you're probably thinking Patti because when I did one Star Search, I sang Patti LaBelle's version of Over the Rainbow. But from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, I was born in a small town called McKees Rocks. And my mom sings, my aunt sings.
Yeah, Crystal.
My dad played guitar. They had a group together. So when I was 3, they put me on stage for the first time with them at 3. And then my mom and dad broke up. And then my mom and my aunt got on the Greyhound bus and moved. We all drove the Greyhound bus to California.
The Greyhound bus.
Yeah, from Pittsburgh because they wanted to pursue their singing careers. But once when I got off the Greyhound bus, Wanda from the Emotions was waiting for me. She's the one to pick me up from the Greyhound station.
How are they? Her husband I went to school with, and I can't remember his name now.
Wayne?
Yeah, Wayne.
Oh, they're good. They're
Have you seen them lately?
I talk to them all the time.
Oh, gosh. I got to talk to them. I haven't talked to them in a long time. I went to school with Wayne.
I can touch with them. Yeah, they're good people.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely they are.
So So Wanda picked me up from the Greyhound station. When I got to California, I immediately told my mom I wanted to sing too. So they got me a commercial agent. I was 8 years old. I auditioned for my first commercial, and it was to scat with Ella Fitzgerald in the Kentucky Fried Chicken commercial. I got the part at 8 years old. And
I don't know why you're going out a little bit.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, now we can hear you. It was kind of going out there.
Yeah. So it's just a long story. So I won Star Search. I got my first record deal when I was 11 years old. I was signed to A&M Records.
John McClain, of course.
Yes.
John McClain is who put us with Interscope. Jimmy Iovine. Interscope.
John is the best. So yes. I was 11 years old. He heard about me. I was singing in a musical. He came to hear me sing and immediately signed me when I was 11 years old.
That's John.
John doesn't really come out. He's almost kind of like a recluse. Have you heard from him lately?
I talk to him every couple of years. Like, you know, we'll have every couple of years. I haven't physically seen him in.
Yeah,
you won't.
He's like Charlie from Charlie's Angels.
Yeah.
You can talk to him, but you won't see.
He was a blessing when we met him. Let me tell you that. Yeah.
Blessing for you.
Yeah, we got, many of you don't know John McClain, but he's kind of a power broker in the music industry, and he was with A&M Records. And
He was with Jimmy, and he started Interscope with Jimmy, and then he broke away.
John McClain started Interscope.
And he also he works the estate for Michael Jackson. He's someone to know, but you don't see him too often.
But yeah, he's one of those musical guys.
And he plays guitar, he's a musician as well. Yeah.
And he loves fine art. We got into fine art a lot more because of John McClain.
He said, Vicki, what art piece did he send you?
He sent me an Ernie Barnes limited edition. Piece.
Wow.
So he was courting us.
Yeah, I mean, when you're courted by John McClain.
Yeah. It was a gospel centric and stuff. Yeah, so he was courting us. Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah, so you have a 5-octave range. Now, we talked to Ernest Pugh. He has a 5-octave range, but that is very hard to come by. And then they said you have this unique thing where you can sing in a whistle. What does that mean?
A whistle?
It's Minnie Riperton loving you.
Oh. So Mariah Carey can do that too then, huh?
Yeah.
So what is that? That's past a range of octaves? What is it?
I believe so. It's like, it's a note that you hit that's pretty up there, I guess.
But the angels? Is the angel?
We was sitting screech trying to sound like you and trying to sound like Minnie Riperton doing that loving you song. We ain't got it.
It was a note that I used to hit back in the day, and I just
you know it's deep. It's deep because Minnie Riperton's widower, which is Dick Rudolph. When I first signed to A&M Records, he was he executive produced an album that A&M, it was never released. So he put me in the studio with Tina Marie. I worked with New Edition, Ricky and Rob produced a song on me. And we had a really dope album, and A&M just took that album, put it to the side, and started all over again. But I was thinking about Minnie Riperton because that's so deep, because that was my first, Dick Rudolph was my first producer.
Where is all that music, girl?
It's just never.
You need to see if you can find it out of a vault.
I reached out to Tina Marie's daughter the other day because I asked her, you know, is it okay if I at least put the song up on my Instagram so people can hear it? And she said, absolutely. So I'm gonna put up the Tina Marie song for sure.
Oh, great! So we can hear that. That'll be great. And so,
one thing I love, you sing opera for us one time in the office. It was a Pavarotti song. And I think people love you for R&B and pop. But what they don't know is if you opera,
I don't think you've ever let the people hear all that your voice can do. One time I heard. Pardon me?
I also did Broadway. I was an Eponine and Lady. So that's kind of like somewhat of an opera as well.
Yeah, I mean, but the length of your voice, I just want people. I heard you one day, an honoring for Chaka Khan. I'll never forget that as long as I live.
Oh my God, I had to sit when I was in front of her. I was
like, Chaka was right there. But baby, you were singing Chaka.
Thank you.
You were singing.
You know Chaka is critical.
Chaka, very critical.
Yes, and I just thought, my goodness, I want people. You sing really nice songs, and we all love. I like your smile. But Shanice, when are we gonna get to hear the whole breadth of your voice?
So I love your smile. I know it was, you know, real simple and everything, but when you go deep into the album, there's so many other songs that they don't release that is that I'm doing more vocally, and you know, it just breaks my heart that a lot of times, like, they'll put out their first single, and then after the first single, they're on to the next, and then it's like there's so many other great songs that I want them to put out and just never ever get to.
Sometimes they don't even like if you go out, is the full album out there or just your singles?
Oh, no, I have full albums.
Well, we're going to have to dig into those full albums. But, like, just hearing you sing live and you've sung at our house, ha-ha, you guys. No, I shouldn't brag like that.
But I wanted to talk about Chaka. She really inspired me. When I was 7 months, my mom has it on cassette. My first song I ever sang was Tell Me Something Good by Chaka Khan. And I was
seven.
I could sing the melody. I couldn't say the words correctly, but I had the melody down pat. And a lot.
7 months.
Yeah.
Seven months.
7 months.
That's what I keep
seven
saying.
Months. No.
She said 7 months.
Did you say 7 months?
My mom, she has it on cassette.
Get out of here, Vicki.
On the cassette, she talked about the year it was.
7 months.
Yeah. So when I did that tribute that, you know, you came to and I was singing for Chaka, it was just blowing my mind that, wow, my first song that I ever sang was Chaka. I'm sitting here singing for, you know, for Chaka. So that's
my mind wouldn't process.
Yeah, we could.
My mind would not process that.
She said seven months.
I want to pull out.
You know, one of the things we find out, and we've talked to a lot of different folks, that gift comes out early.
And I mean, even with you, Flex, I couldn't believe this, that you choreographed for Queen Latifah. And who was the other person?
Well, it was, I danced for Queen Latifah, video, I choreographed that video. Salt and Pepper, I was a main dancer.
Choreographer
for. God, I worked with so many people. I was able to travel the world at a young age. I love dance.
We dance a lot together. We got to have our party sometime again.
I know. I mean, that's why when the pandemic hit and, you know, we started getting on DJing. I started DJing like in 2015. On every Thursday night, but when the pandemic hit and we just started getting on, like, it really was a healing.
Yes. Music. You're still doing that DJing, and you got your cheerleader Shanice in there.
I'm a high girl.
VIP section.
You can't. I don't know if you can see this. All the people just talking about how beautiful you guys are, and I mean.
We see
Brooklyn
Jones.
Came in and said hi. Granddaddy came in.
Yeah, my dad got on. He's 93 and he's still golfing.
He wrote in to say hi to you guys.
Are you still golfing, Flex?
Oh, I love it. Love it.
I mean, can we brag a little bit?
The one you got to tell you was him.
Can we brag a little bit about some of the people? I remember one time you were on the phone, you said, I'm golfing right now. I'm here with Samuel Jackson. He wasn't bragging. He was just saying he was busy. And I'm like, okay. Samuel L. Jackson. Go back and do that.
All those guys. Sam Jackson. I played with, you know, Anthony Anderson, Michael Jordan, Ray Allen.
Michael Jordan.
I know you'll be here.
Chris Spencer.
Yeah. Chris Spencer. That's my ultimate golf buddy. We have a great crew of just black entertainers and a clique that we play golf, we have fun. There's some guys, you know, put the cigars out, we got the speaker on. We just having fun, man. It's I just love being out there. Obviously I love the competition, but I just love being out there with my friends.
That's great.
And it's an outlet, you know, I need that.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's what I told her when we got together. I said, listen, you cannot take my golf away.
No, I got to say one thing. When we first got married, he was golfing like six days a week. I'm not lying.
That's a lot.
And you know with golf, it's like, it takes like 5 hours to play.
5 hours.
It would take him an hour to get to the course. He would play 5 hours, then he would eat.
Explain that.
Sorry.
So it was beginning, and again, it goes back, Claude, to what I was saying. I didn't know anything about how to be a husband. I didn't know I needed to be there. I was still in the mode of, hey, man, I'm going to play golf.
So you remember that one day this is
what I would do.
I came home. I came home one day after golf. She's sitting over there with
a bottle of wine.
She's like, listen, I don't know about this marriage.
Listen, I got a new name for Claude. Because, you know, sometimes men get like that. They think about what they want to do, and they forget about us a little bit. So he starts saying, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do that. So I got a nickname for him, and I call him I'ma Do.
Oh, her nickname is...
I'ma Do.
Her nickname is I'm About To.
Yeah, you know. But,
on the bottom...
This fool was bringing out scripture.
I saw the scripture that said,
you're supposed to be home.
Or somebody
a whole year.
I showed him some scripture in the Bible that said that.
That's right, Shani.
Oh, my
God. She broke it down.
And then I pulled that out. I was like, well, a wife was supposed to cook some.
Yeah, here we go.
It's funny.
Down
Oh yeah, she pulled out that scripture. I pulled out. I said, "Well, it is better to be on the roof of a house."
Oh yeah, that was. Awesome.
Yeah, it gets kind of rough when folks start pulling out the scripture for what's supposed to be happening. But this is Amadou over here. Amadou. So, Shami had a question?
I had a question. I just wanted to switch it a little bit because, Shanice, you performed at the Soul Cypher.
Yes.
Past year, that was amazing. And it was with Stokely and PJ Morton.
And Shani.
And, yeah. But you were amazing. And I wanted to know, what was that experience like? Because, you know, award shows are being done virtually. And then also to, did you guys host as well this year?
We hosted the pre-show. So that
we did okay, yeah. Pre-show. That's right. I saw that.
And that was fun. Flex. The Cypher, I was so honored to be on stage with those amazing vocalists. PJ, like Stokely was the dream team. And they told me like a few days before the show, they asked me if I wanted to do it. So I had like a couple of days to really, they gave me the track. They said, "We want you to write to this Erykah Badu track." I had to come up with 16 bars really fast. And
What happened?
They came to my house the day of and took COVID.
Normally, it's you take a half and you fit it to the melody of that. But she wrote something.
I wrote a whole new thing. I didn't know that I could have just sang "I Love Your Smile" on top of the Erykah Badu thing. And
it made it so much better. I loved it.
But you are. I mean, you are a writer. You mm-hmm. are an actress in your own right. Kenny Loggins, et cetera, you've done all these great things. But I want to know about now, what is, like I said, we've had the ups and downs, both of us, and now we're going through COVID, and we've had a crazy election and all that. What are you guys, what's happening for you now, and how have you remained so relevant? Your social networking is still high and all that. Tell me how you've been able to do all that.
You know, the deep thing, we talk about it all the time, is that during the pandemic, we've been busier. Mm-hmm. We were busy before, but we were busier during this time.
Like 2020.
And not only just, which was great, but the best thing out of all of it was it brought our family, you know, closer. Not that we weren't before, but it made us cut the fat, trim the fat, and really get back to, you know, sitting down with kids.
We watch movies together.
We sit down watching movies.
We eat together now.
We're not passing each other like ships in the night.
Now, do you have the whole family? Is Crystal and everybody still with you?
No,
everybody's gone. They have their place.
But they're
like 10 minutes away.
Okay, yes.
So how big is your bubble?
Just the four of us and her mother, okay. You know, in-laws. That's really...
Yeah, they come over. Yeah,
yeah, they do come. Julia Bubble, and they're super careful.
And our dog.
And our dog, yeah.
Awesome.
So that was a great part, but we just kept... I mean, it forced us to be creative, like I said, with, you know, DJing, and then she would go on and sing live.
Yeah.
Wow.
Online,
and... so many things came out of it. I started, you know, DJing virtual parties and doing interviews and
I have a lipstick line, so yeah. I've been like pushing.
Yes, yes. How's that going, girl?
Yeah.
I haven't gotten any lipstick yet. Where do I go?
Text me your address. I'm gonna send you some lipstick.
Okay, but I want to know how to buy it too, because I want to support. Okay. And I want to encourage everybody else to do the same thing.
It's smilebyshanice.com.
Okay. I feel bad about that. I usually support better, but I just realized I didn't.
We're sending you some.
No, I was going to.
And I'll buy some too.
But and we see a lot of our people here from the lockdown family, from the lockdown with Flex and Shanice. A lot of the people here that, I mean,
Penny is
who
on there.
Came with us, who rocked with us, you know, day in and day out while we played music, and so many people were just like, man, thank you, this helped us. And
yes, yes, yes.
So they just diehards, and we just stay creative. We just,
and you know what? And Flex, he doesn't let me watch the news, so yeah. I might watch the news a little bit. And then because I, at first when the pandemic hit, I kind of went into a depression and I had a lot of fear, you know, just
oh, okay.
Understandably.
CNN. And,
yeah. And we're going, because she's like, well, I just need to know what's going on. I'm like, no, you don't. You fine. You don't need to know, because everything was negative. Everything was negative.
Yeah, everything, yeah.
Fear.
I'm a new junkie.
And she's a new junkie.
Yeah,
I pop in every now and then to get something, but I
yeah, I told her, I said, listen, you know, you pray and you strong in that, you don't need to worry. Period. Just leave it alone, because the two right. two can't coexist. So, yeah. What they say, boo boo, or get off the potty. So,
right. Oh, you saying it so nice. Boo boo, or get off the potty. Okay, I'm gonna use that one. But so, now, yeah. I saw you with what's his name, Kenan from
yes.
So yeah. What's happening with that?
Thompson. Well, I've been reoccurring. I'm on the second season of I did a couple of episodes in the first season, and I'm on the second season of Mixed Dish as well on ABC.
Oh, okay.
Tuesday night. I played George, the new neighbor, and I was on Kenan Thompson's show on NBC. Kenan, we did Snakes on a Plane together, known him for years.
Yes.
Such a lovely, great dude, man. Just he was so cool. He was excited, and we sat and we talked, and it's all different now. You got to take all these tests. And you know, you really can't, even though you know, you take a test and you're clear to be there, everyone is still respecting that it's good. So I just need that. That's going to be airing soon. So
is there anything we can do to
Kimry is on there.
To, oh yeah, Kimry, our friend Kimry.
Kimry, yes. Kimry, my scenes with Kimry. She is an absolute certified nut. She's crazy.
Isn't she amazing?
She's awesome. Yeah.
We went to high school together.
Yeah, they went to high school together.
Yeah, she's amazing.
She's awesome. We had a great time, and yeah. You know, I look forward to getting back there, hopefully at some point. But it was fun. I'm just thankful to be able to still keep going. And now, Smith, my wife is just booked. She's going on. They called her to come on and be on the First Wives Club with Jill Scott and.
Okay.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
What can we do to help support? Like, when we like something or we like an artist on a show, what should we do? Put it on our sites or call up, right? What?
Yeah, we'll let you know, when it airs.
When it airs, you can just, post it. Keep seeing more of them or whatever.
So I've been doing, it's crazy because it's a pandemic. I've been doing more acting. Mm-hmm. And I'm a series called Stuck With You.
With Pete Cuffey.
Okay. But it hasn't come out yet, or it's come out? Stuck With You.
Uh-huh.
It's on UMC.
UMC. They just changed it.
UMC.
They changed the name of it. It's called All Black.
All Black now.
All Black.
Okay.
So you've had to pull out your acting skills.
Yes.
And how about your mom? Is she doing her singing? Still doing?
Yes. My mom and my aunt, they're still singing. They still have their group. They're just trying to figure out this new way of doing everything online and things. So they're going to start singing more online.
Okay.
All right.
Now, I have something I haven't talked online about, but I think about you guys a lot because you have kids with allergies like me. And I'm coming out with, I want to send you guys, you're just listening to us talk. We just having our regular conversation. I'm going to send you guys, I started a no-nut spread. It tastes like peanut butter, but there's no nuts in it, no tree nuts, nothing.
That's great.
I love that.
So I'm going to send you some. I'm going to try to do it this week so you can be a taster for me.
We have three flavors.
Yeah.
Regular, which is like a peanut, a pumpkin spice, which is my favorite, and chocolate. So we, she doesn't like
that. Do both of your children have allergies?
Just Imani.
Imani can't have any tree nuts. Like, she can't have almonds or walnuts or peanuts.
Okay. Right.
Well, this she's down with this. She can do
this. She's going to love this thing.
Nice.
And your son is 15 now. He looks just like you, but a straight.
Oh, no.
He'll be 17.
17.
My mom's son is perfect. Yes. She just wants, she don't want him to grow
He's
up.
Not in college yet, is he?
No. He's a junior.
Is he still a string bean? He's looked like a thin version of you.
He's still athletic.
No, yes. You know what? He's getting buffed.
He's bulking up though, but he's definitely, he's super athletic, fit.
Yeah, he's
What we did is we transformed our garage into a gym. So we have, you know, treadmill, bench, weights. So we're out there working out.
We gotta work out together then, yeah.
Yes. And he looks just like you.
Yeah.
He looks just like you, spit him out. And Imani, that child is beautiful. How are you going to deal with that, Daddy? Or how are you dealing with that at 20?
Really, really trying to learn how to let go a little more, you know?
Yeah,
you know,
a little more. One day when we were downstairs and she was upstairs and she texted us both. She did a group text and she said, "Can we talk?" And we're like, yeah. And she said, "You know, you guys treat me like a baby." And, you know, so...
Oh,
we're trying to learn how to kind of let go a little bit because she will be 20.
Yeah.
And it's so hard.
You have to say to people that do it when their child's almost going to be 40. So what do you have to tell
them? I told her, I said, even when you're 50, and I told Elijah this, I said, you're still going to be my baby.
I mean, it's very.
You can't let that go, but you got to.
It's very difficult. I never let go completely. You know, we got a new grandbaby.
I know.
Whoa.
No, I know.
Yes, two boys.
Oh, no, not
until you get that. Wow.
Well, I knew about the first. There's two now?
We got a second one. He's about a month or so old.
Wow. Oh, congratulations.
Thank you. Wait until you get into that.
He's a little buster.
Yeah,
now your kids are doing online learning right now? Is that what they're doing? So
Elijah probably.
Yeah, you know, for high school, or is he actually going into school?
For school online,
yeah.
School, are you guys involved in that, or he's pretty responsible to do that?
You know what? He's on. He has a 4.0 grade point average right now.
Wow! Go ahead, young lady.
Yeah. Elijah's doing
it.
Yeah. Wow! We're happy. We're proud of both of them. We're just.
Wow.
You know, because we really understand. We really do have some good kids and. You know, we tell them, listen, sorry if we're a little overzealous here, a little overprotective, but
that's what happens.
Different now. It's not like when we came up. It's just different. And we got it differently. And I always tell them, you know, we tell our daughter, like, okay, listen, you'll see when you have.
But now, I mean, as Black parents and high visibility celebrities, you still have to be concerned about somebody trying to shoot your kids or going off on them, or I mean, the thought of it.
Yeah, we had, talking to our son, saying, "Hey, man, you African American kid, and you know, we went before the pandemic. He had friends that had cars, and I'm like, no, you're not getting in the car with four or five of y'all. That's a recipe for getting pulled over.
Yeah, for something crazy to happen."
So I try to, you know, teach him, you know, obviously be respectful and all that and just do what you're told if you pulled over, you know, even though we know that doesn't always mean that it's going to work out. But I think that's a high probability of at least, you know, you being able to come home safely. And with our daughter, too, because it's no respecter of person or gender. It is males, females, everyone. They, you know, we have
it hits everybody.
Yeah, have to have that conversation. And it's sad that we have to have a conversation now that was what, not 65 years ago, we're just being able to have civil rights. You know what I mean? And which is mind blowing that we're not that far away from that.
Yeah, it's
you know, we said we're gonna pray at the end. We've got
we do need to pray.
But just before I do that, you know, I'm an Omega, you're
a Sigma.
We all won. We all won.
But yeah, we do need to just take a moment. They asked that we take a moment to pray for Dr. Fred Price, who's in the hospital now with COVID. Right. Do you want to lead it?
Yeah, just leave it. Father God in heaven, we just thank you that your love for us is true and real every day. So we lift up our brother and Dr. Frederick Craig Price. He's in the hospital. We just pray for those that are taking care of him. Give them wisdom. Give them what they need, the right therapeutics, Father God. We ask that you would bring healing in his body, total and complete healing, we pray. And we ask this in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. So,
on top of that, those people who in Dallas, they had that huge
that car accident.
100 cars.
And 100 what?
Oh, no, we didn't hear that.
Yeah, it was ice on the road, and cars were going full speed and slamming each other. 130-something cars, I think. And so far, six people have passed. And there are tons of injuries, so we send out those families.
Yes.
I had to call Celeste to make sure she was okay because it was in the Fort Worth area.
Celeste is Kirk Franklin's sister.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Right. Man. Yeah. So.
We gotta lift everybody.
Well, we want to thank you for bringing so much joy. We wanted to keep it up. I mean, when we talk, it's always fun and up. You guys are a beautiful couple. We just pray that you just continue having success. And
bless you guys.
Just everything good for you we want. And we'll be talking to you soon because I have a birthday coming up and we might have to have a little party.
Congratulations on your 21st and the 19th.
Thank you. This will be the first anniversary that I'm going to be out of town.
Together.
I'm going to be working.
You're going to be out of town. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Well.
Be safe.
We gotta do.
Yeah.
We gotta do what we gotta do. Yeah. It's gotta happen, and you know, in 21 years, it's gotta happen. It's happened to us in 40 years.
So. Yeah, we're 40 years.
Wow. 40 years.
40 years married. Yes. Yeah. I know, honey. It is a miracle from God Himself. Yes. But we've done it. So bye-bye, and we'll call you guys later. We love you so much.
I love you. Guys.
Oh, we want to play something.
We were going to play some I Love Your Smile.
Well, come on. Can you do it real fast?
Yeah.
And we'll, I don't want to get knocked off real fast, so we're going to try to. I like your smile.
You have to turn it up. Okay. For watching Carpetable Talks.
Yes,
please remember to press that like button, and we need you to subscribe and also
leave some comments. We really need to hear from you.
Thank you.